Thank you very much to Sarah for helping to fund the project I'm going to be talking about today and for inviting me to speak here today. I'm going to tell you a little bit about our farm. We're an unusual farm, so I'm going to unpack that a little bit for you about what Sola Gratia is about. And then the second half of my presentation will be about our outreach and education program and how working with youth through day camps and a community garden and a few other programs really helps to build community in a couple of unique ways. So, and if you have any questions, feel free, you know, while I'm talking, to just go ahead and raise your hand. Yes. Let's see. So, our farm was started 5 years ago by St. Matthew Lutheran Church. They had 4 acres of row crop agriculture, and they were using the land to raise money to support world hunger relief. So one of the ministries of the church is to help those that are in need. And there was an individual named Brian Sauter from an organization called Faith in Place. Faith in Place is a nonprofit organization in Illinois that works with congregations to become better environmental stewards. And he had his office there and would look out on this, you know, corn and beans and said, you know, there's a lot of hungry people in our own community that could be benefiting from your outreach. And what, you know, what do you think about a community farm? Which at first, I think the idea was well received, but it was like, you know, it seemed onerous and like a lot of work. But plans came together over a year's time, and they decided to turn 4 acres of corn and beans into vegetables that could feed those that are hungry in our community. So Champaign County has a 17.6 food insecurity rate, which is actually higher than Chicago. So unfortunately, we have a lot of people that don't have their needs met in our community. So our farm was turned into something that could give a significant amount of produce, fresh, nutritious local produce to those in need in our community. So we still are hosted and supported by St. Matthew Lutheran Church. We work in partnership with Faith in Place. We run a 120-member community-supported agriculture program. We sell our produce at 2 farmers markets, our local food cooperative, several restaurants. And all this is done by 2 full-time staff, 2 part-time staff, and a whole team of volunteers. So our vision and mission are by grace alone. May we share our gifts with the hungry, may we be good stewards of the earth, and may we build a community of cooperation and care. So everything we do is really guided by these principles. So the community hunger assistance piece of that is we are committed to donate at least 10% of everything we grow to the food bank in our community, food pantries, the local men's homeless shelter, women's shelter, and the public health district. Over 5 years, we've averaged 30% of everything we've grown, we've given through those outlets, and that's amounted to, I think I'm getting ahead of myself, but 35,000 pounds of produce. So that, our growing season has been, now we have a new hoop house, but it has been largely June through November. So on the left, you can see that's the food bank with one of our final distributions to them. They come with their a truck every Friday. It used to be every Monday, now it's every Friday. And we just send everything that we have to them that is going to hold because the food bank has to distribute and there's a certain amount of time that's needed there. Anything that is ripe and needs to get out quickly, we'll take directly to public health district, to the men's homeless shelter, the women's shelter. And we really kind of judge what's going where based on the desire. I mean, there's a lot of storage crops that are needed by the food bank. If something needs to be used quickly, that's going to the soup kitchen because they'll use it right away and it'll be taken. So it's a little bit of a puzzle each week, but we make sure that as much as we can is going where it's needed. So this is a picture of Chuck. He's the truck driver for the food bank. Oh, I think I'm going, whoops. There we go. And so this last year we were awarded the Community Partner of the Year by the Eastern Illinois Food Bank, so that was quite an honor. It's been fantastic working with them. Really, the logistics are so key. I mean, anyone who's growing food knows that you have to be really smart and timely and efficient about what you're doing. So they've been a fantastic partner to work with. And so each year we talk with them and say, how's it going? What kind of crops do you need more or less of? Is the quality okay? Do we need to change logistics? And they've been fantastic. Our CSA program, we run 6 months, so 24 weeks. We grow 150 varieties of 50 different vegetables. Weekly pickups on the farm. We have half shares and full shares available. Largely, we get about 20% of our shares that are purchased specifically for donation. So that allows us to increase the amount of produce that's actually going out and being donated. So people, a lot of people buy share for themselves or share for donation, or half share for themselves, half share for donation. Some people are donation only, some people are pickup only. It doesn't matter to us, except for I am always kind of edging towards more for donation because that's the point of our farm. But largely, this CSA program is what makes all of this possible. We believe in sustainable farming practices and follow organic practices, though we are not certified. We work on enhancing soil structure and biology by using cover crops, crop rotation, on-site composting, minimal cultivation. We harvest as close as we can to dead on ripe and making sure that we're getting things so that they go to market when they're fresh and co-op when they're fresh and to our CSA customers when they're fresh, which takes a lot, you know, a lot of logistics, especially since we're working with so many volunteers, but that's the whole point of local. We are a low budget farm, so some of our tools are handmade and take some creativity. So on the left is our dibbler, made out of a bike frame by one of our previous farm managers. This is one of our cedars named Puddin. Still has the basket and the tassels. This is our flame burner, and this year is going to be improved by our new farm manager, Hunter, with an external frame, backpack, because that is extremely heavy to carry through the field. But that's an important weeding technique that we use. This is another one of our cedars. This is an Earthways, which we actually all can't stand because, well, if anyone's ever used it, they don't actually work that well. But so this is on our wish list of getting a better cedar. And then these are our wheel hose, which are old bicycle frames. So we have some unique things going on our farm. Keep us in budget. We have a greenhouse, which is about 850 square feet of growing space. So we start all of our own plants for the field and for our plant sale, which is a big farm fundraiser for us. And we also donate a lot of transplants to community gardens in the area. We have a cold frame here that we use to harden off all of our transplants before they go in the field. And then this last year, with the support of the Lumpkin Foundation, we were able to purchase a used hoop house, which gives us 3,200 more feet of squaring, so 3,200 square feet of growing space, which will allow us to grow earlier in the season and later in the season. So we planted last year before we even constructed the frame. We had, turnips, radishes, spinach, arugula, all sorts of bunching greens in there. And this will, I think, will be a really important place for us to, one, take some pressure off the field so we can do more cover crops and let the soil rest and build, as well as enhance some of our more quality crops like tomatoes, where we can have them in controlled conditions. Let's see. So this is Hunter. He's our farm manager. Myself. These are two of our part-time staff that have been with us 2 and 3 years. And this is our farm coordinator, treasurer, and board member, Todd. So we're fortunate to have people stay with us. There's a lot, you know, a lot of turnover would be hard on our farm because there's so many people and partnerships and relationships involved. But we've got a good crew. And community building. This is a part that when I came on, I believe strongly that this is a point that we can do so much more to enhance and will only keep giving back to the farm and make us stronger in the long run. We live in a great community. We have a food co-op. We have a number of community gardens. We have a lot of people that are working on local ag. There's a lot of actual, you know, really good farms in the area that are, you know, good partners in terms of like sharing information and equipment and being supportive. Volunteers are something that's pretty unique to our farm. I think because of the mission, people are really drawn to our farm. We also have a really kind of easy way to fold people in. We train folks. We, you know, play to their strengths. We have lots of different jobs that they can do. And it's really become a family where, you know, people celebrate their anniversaries there, for example, or have birthday parties there, or really, like, we have to have happy hours and dinners throughout the off season because we really miss each other. So this is, you know, it's a really special thing. It's hard work. A lot of our volunteers are retirees, but it really enriches the experience and brings more people into the fold of what we're trying to accomplish. We have a number of events. I mentioned our spring plant sale, which is a big fundraiser for us. We also have a fall plant sale. We do farm-to-table dinners. We do on-farm tours. The Illinois Organic Growers Association has had for the last 2 years a crop cycle, which is a bicycle tour that visits different farms in the area. So we've been the lunch sites for the last 2 years. We have summer feed and weed potlucks, which is a way to bring people together en masse, you know, in a group to help weed when things get out of control in June and July, as they always seem to do. And then we have a good harvest party in the fall to celebrate the season. And I'm always looking for more things to do. This is a lot of text, but I really felt like it was important to list all the different partnerships we have in the community, because that's what one sets us apart, makes us special, and makes it so rewarding to do what we do. So we have strong, and that's a lot of what I do in the wintertime, is I'm meeting with people, making sure we're still on track. What can we do to, you know, better these partnerships and be more efficient in what we're trying to accomplish? So we work with the hunger assistance programs. We have great relationships with both of our market managers, all of our retail wholesale outlets. We have three community gardens in town that we try as much as we can to support them with seeds, with transplants, with tools. You know, there are peer farms that really give us help with advice and equipment and just general support. And then another number of not-for-profit organizations and service organizations we're grateful for. So, outreach and education is something that I never feel like I have enough time for, but it's extremely rewarding and enriching, and has been building over the last 3 years. So, we started really, I think, aside from a few special events, our big entrance into building our outreach education program was with the Champaign County Farm Bureau, who, in partnership with the Champaign Park District, was going to be offering day camps. So they wanted to have a day camp that was a beginning farmer camp. And they had kids through the Champaign Park District, largely subsidized, kids that were subsidized, coming from low-income families, go to a large grain operation, go to a livestock farm, and then they wanted one to be a small-scale fruit or vegetable farm. So we felt really honored that Champaign County Farm Bureau asked us to be their vegetable farm, the small-scale vegetable farm. So I said yes, kind of not even asking how many kids are we talking about. Probably should have asked that question. We ended up with 70 kids on our little farm the first year, which kind of terrified the farm manager at the time. And it was, of course, day camp happens when kids are out of school, which is June, July, and August, which is also the crazy time of, you know, you're planting, you're weeding, you're harvesting. There's so much going on then. But it was extremely rewarding. The night before the camp started that week, there was an event at Douglas Park, which you'll hear more about, that was for the families of the kids that were going to be part of that camp. So it was a large, you know, the Farm Bureau was out and they had a number of different tents on different agricultural products. I was there talking about vegetables and brought some clay for kids to make their favorite fruit and vegetables out of. And it was really touching to see how many kids and their parents and their grandparents came up and started tasting vegetables that I had out, asking questions about the funky vegetables they'd never seen before, like patty pan squash. Like, is this real? You know, you look at it, it looks like it's a Play-Doh product. And they would talk about the gardens, you know, the grandparents would talk about the gardens that they used to have, and the kids would say, like, how do you grow this? And it was clear to me that, one, there was interest in fresh food. Two, there was an intergenerational opportunity there. And these kids, at least that were there that evening, didn't have a lot of access to seeing how a garden grew, or like how vegetables grow, or how to pick their own. So I started talking to the Champaign Park District staff that were there that night and said, have you guys ever thought about a community garden? Because this is a huge park. They have a baseball diamond, they have a splash pad, a playground. There's a library there, a senior center, and a community center. I mean, there's a lot of things going on there. And there's also a lot of open grass, full sun open grass. So my eyes are always looking at, like, you know, what can you grow there? And heard from them that night that they tried for 2 years unsuccessfully to get a garden started. And they just didn't have the resources. I said, well, what if I, you know, what if I helped? What if we donated the transplants? What if we, you know, planted it for you and got it started? Could we work together on this? And so that was, you know, an immediate yes. Like, yes, let's do it. So we started talking. We applied for a grant, I think that might have been our SARE grants that we first applied for. I think we decided we would do it at some level, whether we had funding or not, because there was will there, and will and want. The grant helped tremendously with buying supplies that were needed for the garden and for, you know, everything that comes along with it, which you'll see. But we got started right away. I think once everybody was on board, we kicked it off. So these are pictures of the camp that we started with. So we had a cooking class was one module, field work, you know, field identification, walking out and see how vegetable grows was another. This is Maggie Wachter, who Rachel was just talking about. So she came and talked about bees and pollination with the kids, because we have four hives on our sites, and that's an important piece of our farm ecology. And then I ran a nutrition module where we were talking about food groups and superfoods, and so I was challenging the kids to come up with like superfood super characters. So you'll see some pictures of like, you know, carrots lifting cars and you know, broccoli beating up an ice cream cone, or, you know, there's all these fun ways in art that they show that they understand superfood nutrition concepts. So this is the camp that kicked off the whole idea. We started talking right away, and of course this was, we had the camp in the summer, and we decided in the fall is when we could start on the community garden. So there wasn't a whole lot we could do in the fall. A lot of the programming was actually inside, which, you know, is hard with the age kids I was working with were 5 to 12. So given that most of them didn't have gardening experience, it was hard to say, let's imagine, you know, imagine a garden, or imagine the plant like looks like this. So it was really a challenge for me to start with them in a way that, you know, would get them excited. And at least in year one, I had all of the kids in the after-school program. So Douglas Community, so the Douglas Park has a community center that hosts an after-school program with kids from six different elementary schools. So all of these kids coming in, there were 25, 30 kids there. And so I was working with all of them, which if any of you have worked with 25 to 30, 5 to 12-year-olds, it's a challenge to keep everyone on the same page. But we started with the concept of pioneers. What is a pioneer? And a pioneer is someone who hasn't done something. You know, you're doing something for the first time. You're going someplace for the first time. And so we walked the site, which was just a grassy patch at first, and started imagining, you know, taking note and drawing sketches and making a map of what's there. And then we started talking about, you know, what if we started growing food here? Nobody's done it before. What if you want, do you want to be a pioneer and try this for the first time? And it was really interesting having that conversation with them, because they would look around and they could imagine, yeah, we could grow some food here, and what would it take? And we talk about we'd need water, we need sun, and we need good soil, and we need the seed or the plant, and, you know, all of that came with the program we did in the wintertime. But I'll tell you, one of the fears of the kids I was working with that initial planting, they were really afraid of what would happen with all of this work in such a public space. And they really, like, there were some hard conversations about, like, what if someone comes and destroys your garden? Or what if you have a tomato plant full of tomatoes and someone takes all of them? So that was, and we just kind of left it at the I wonder stage. I wonder what'll happen. Who, you know, and it was partly people, some rabbits, some squirrels, maybe, you know, just all the things that come with gardening or farming that you'd have to worry about. And we just kind of left it there for a while. Went inside, started doing experiments like, here we were cutting sweet potatoes and trying to grow some roots and leaves on the windowsill. We did an experiment of, you know, if you cut a potato and you have the eyes, is it better to have the eyes up or the eyes down? And so we kind of watched on the windowsill to see where the roots were going to be coming from. We did a big voting exercise of what, you know, what do we want to grow? And I told them, you know, first year, like, let's take it easy. You know, let's pick 10 to 12 different fruits and vegetables, and we ended up with like 30, because pretty much everything I presented to them, they said, yes, 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 let's grow. So we made plants markers in anticipation of what we'd be planting. We used a felt board to kind of keep track of things. So the felt board was where we made the map so we could kind of visualize what was going where. We divided things into food groups so they understood, sorry, not food groups, different types of plants. So we help them understand, you know, in this plant, this you eat the leaves. In this plant, you eat the flowers. In this plant, you eat the fruit. So they could understand different growing techniques. And so we separated them out here into the roots, fruits, and shoots. Here, we were experimenting with just grass seed, trying to grow grass seed in their They wrote with glue and then sprinkled grass seed on, and so they could grow grass and see what that looks like and under different conditions. So inside was a lot of like laboratory experiments and just biding our time waiting for the spring. Then we broke ground, and the park district's deal with me was, we'll cut the sod, but you have to remove it, which if anybody ever says that to you, don't do it. I thought it was a great deal because we didn't have to rent a sod cutter, but my husband and I hauled all of this under a tight deadline in I don't know how many truckloads, and I will never do that again. So don't make that mistake. But this is the ground. I mean, it was all grass, it was all sod beforehand, removed it, and we immediately put our sign out there of Douglas Park Community Garden coming soon. So that was a signal that this is something we're doing to the neighborhood, and we were hoping to attract other people as well to be interested in it. We invited them out to the farm so that they could see kind of who their, you know, their parent farm people were. This is Farmer Clay here. And so they helped us. We have a tumbler, soil mixer. They helped us mix soil for planting their seeds. We went into the greenhouse and they planted some of their own seeds. But I mean, we went through the exercise of planting seeds, but we also planted our own because if you've ever seeded with kids, you need a backup plan. And we showed them, you know, kind of what we were growing. We got out the tractor, started our walk behind tractor because, you know, big engines are always fun with kids. So it was fun for them to come out and see what we're doing and have a context for where I was coming from. Then we cut up our potatoes, and the first things we planted were potatoes, onions, let's see, we have potatoes here, some onions here, lettuce, a couple kinds of lettuce, and then a bunch of brassicas, so cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli, a couple kinds of kale. And you know, I have to say, coming from the production farm and spacing everything perfectly and in a straight row to working with the kids' garden, I really had to sit on my hands a little bit because they have their own ideas. We talked about, spacing, kind of some of the considerations, but they made it their own. So there was a potato area, roughly. There was an onion area. But in order to get them engaged and have fun and feel like they were contributing something, I wanted them to take ownership and the leaders stepped forward, and there were some kids a lot of kids didn't even want to get dirty to begin with because they were going to get in trouble by their parents for coming home with dirty shoes or dirty pants. So we really had to kind of inch our way into it. Then we had a grand opening, so Douglas Park was getting a whole makeover from the city of Champaign. A number of things were coming in, and our garden was one of them. So we had a really fun time with the ribbon cutting here. And by then, we'd planted everything. So all of our cucurbits were in, our tomatoes and peppers. The whole garden was planted at that point. And unfortunately, it was on a weekend, and I couldn't get the kids that were there during the week to come for the weekend. So I just hung some pictures, took pictures of some of our times together, them planting, and the activities that we did. So at least the people who were visiting on the weekend could see this is a kids' project. And then these are some of our board members from Sola Gratia Farm that were there in attendance. And then our first summer was awesome. It was great. So many things grew so fast. The soil quality actually didn't look great to begin with. And with it being an urban site, honestly, there's like a lot of broken grass and litter, and it's just dry, broken down soil, but it performed very well. I was impressed. So we had a lot. We had sweet potatoes that year. We had corn that year, tomatoes, eggplant, a lot of different crops. I learned really quickly, watering is a really dangerous thing with kids, and you have to be firm and have a plan. This whole like waiting in line for the water wand didn't work real well and resulted in many water fights and some upset parents. And so there are just things you learn along the way of how much leeway to give. And I have my own kids, but boy, working with up to 20, 25 in the garden at one time, I had to pare down the next year. Then one thing that's hard about gardening with kids, especially through school program, is the academic year doesn't really line up that nicely with the growing season. So, my kids in the garden club, we were working in the winter, the first winter, to do make all the plans, and then we planted everything. But those poor kids, like, they worked so hard, and they didn't really get to reap the benefit of their work. So I said goodbye to them at the end of the year and just said, you know, imagine, or please come bring your family back. You're welcome back into the garden. You know, come see what you've started. The kids that got to take over next were part of a day camp program. It was a girls' science day camp program. It was an 8-week program through Champaign Park District. And here they are. And these girls, I mean, I work with the day camp or the garden club every 2 weeks in the off season. But once the growing season comes, I'm there about once a month. So I really have to step back, and it's a little bit of a leap of faith. Like, you know, every time I come back, is there going to be anything left? But the day camp program and these girls, every single day went out. Every single day went out and weeded. Every single day went out and watered, harvested. They were harvesting for themselves and for the local men's homeless shelter. And every time I showed up, it was just beautiful. Like, they did a great job. So here they are. We did team building exercises like building bean teepees. Not as easy as it looks, especially with kids. So we had a competition with the counselors and with the kids, you know, how to tie it together, how to get it to stay, how to train the beans. First fall, you know, these kids, some of the same kids, a lot of new kids, they showed up, and to them, they've got instant garden. I mean, they just have a garden that now is rich. So they're thrilled, and you can tell in these pictures, they're super happy about filling their bushel baskets with the kale and the tomatoes and the eggplants and pulling carrots out of the ground. So that first year was a little hard in asking people to imagine, but the second year has been a lot easier. We also create journals together. So each week we journal about, you know, what they've learned. Some kids can't write yet and can't read, so some of them are just drawing pictures or, you know, doing what they can to kind of account for what we've been working on. Then we had the pleasure of spreading straw and putting the garden to bed. And we started. Then we took to the classroom again and did art projects. And we harvested our sweet potatoes, made sweet potato pie. We harvested our carrots and made carrot muffins. The next year, and actually that fall is when we won an award from the... So the Champaign Park District nominated us for a statewide award, and we won the Illinois Association of Park Districts Best of the Best award. So that was awesome because it was really, nobody knew how this is going to go. There's a lot of moving parts, and everyone has jobs otherwise. So this was kind of a, you know, icing on the cake, as we have time sort of project, but everyone fell in love with it. And really, the partnership worked fantastic between the Park District and Sola Gratia. So we got that award. We were super proud of it. And what the Champaign Park District came back and said was, you're welcome to double the size of the garden. You're welcome to tear up more sod. Which this time, they tore it up and they took it away. And I showed up and it was a blank slate, which was beautiful. So we came and tilled up the next section, had the kids out to the garden again, and planted seeds. And this year, I really wanted to, and we did a lot of great things the first year, but I wanted to add more, a third dimension. I wanted them to learn more about building up, and I also wanted to incorporate art. Because the first year, it was great. It was a straight garden. But the kids really, I mean, anytime you put color into something or made it fancy in some way, they were, you know, some of the kids aren't so interested in getting dirty, or they aren't so interested in plants, and they really are interested in the art of it. So I partnered with one of our volunteers who is an artist and asked her to come on and bring some projects with her. So we did things like we made God's eyes. That was fun. We made pea trellises with funky strings. We made bean teepees, which if it were up to me, we would just use twine and bamboo stakes. And, you know, no, they brought out every single color of yarn that we had and put glitter on it and all sorts of fun stuff. So that was fun, and I could see, and actually I pared down the group, so it was an optional program, so I wasn't working with all of the after-school kids. Now it was garden club, and it was a choice. So that brought it down to about 12 kids, which was a lot better, because then you didn't have the behavior issues, you only had kids that really, really wanted to be there, and we could focus and get further on the work. So this is the second year of the Girls Science Day Camp program. Again, harvesting and just taking excellent care of the garden. I also really wanted to, you know, we'd baked with the vegetables and we'd eaten them raw. I don't remember that first year cooking any of them, but we introduced them to juicing. So we had a day that was a rainy day and we pulled out cucumbers, carrots, tomatoes. I feel like there was one other thing. Anyway, and that was awesome. Like, if you haven't juiced with a kid before, it's really fun. For them to see that that's another way to consume your vegetables, for them to see the colors mixing in the juicer, they made recipes. You know, they were, say, like, one cucumber and four tomatoes and three carrots. Let's try that. And we had these little Dixie cups, and so we'd have these little taste tests, and that was fun. We're always just trying to help them think about other ways to experience vegetables or growing or tasting something new. They were big fans of eggplants. I don't know if they ever actually took them home and cooked them and ate them, but all of the different shapes and colors, they thought was great. So there was always a little tussle over the clippers and who gets to go get the eggplant. But I thought I'd honor them with these pictures because those are what they're so proud of. And then, you know, we, in the last couple weeks, this is just a couple weeks ago, well, I guess in October we were decorating pumpkins here. We made pumpkin muffins here. We had this huge beet that we couldn't get out of the ground. And has anyone ever heard the story of gigantic turnip? So this is it, like, this is my rainy day activity right here, always, because you can incorporate in about 20 kids into that story. And they act it out. If you just tell the story and they act it out, it's great fun. And so we had one turnip which literally we could not get out of the ground, and it took us like it's kind of munted up a little bit because it took us, you know, pulling and pulling just like the story, and then literally kicking it to get out of the ground. So they were super proud of their big beet that they had grown. And then we we made vegetable soup a couple weeks ago. So we had turnips from the garden, potatoes, carrots, sweet potato I brought in because we didn't grow sweet potatoes this year, Chinese cabbage. I brought these onions and garlic in because we didn't grow onions and garlic, at least to that stage this year. And boy, I mean, these kids, like, you give them a few scrub brushes, they're scrubbing away. We didn't peel anything. They were chopping. You could get them some kid-friendly knives. Chopping, they loved. Mixing, making the soup. And here are kids that at the beginning of the year were not going to eat vegetables, or no way was I going to eat a turnip. And they were, and it was like a connoisseur conversation of, you know, how good it was. And I really like mine with pepper. It was really fun. So we made a huge batch, and they all insisted they take some home. So I ran around trying to find little cups for them to take vegetable soup home. But these are the things that, I mean, really are rewarding about working with the kids, is they start out with worrying who's going to steal their vegetables, getting dirty, not wanting to try something new. And at the end, they're so proud of giving everything to the time center, or they're so proud of being able to make a vegetable soup that they want to share with their parents. And they are not thinking at all about how dirty they're getting, or, you know, the cut that they have on their hand from the straw that we're spreading. So one thing that developed this last year, which was really cool, is Common Ground Food Co-op, which is a local food co-op, they would do a kind of a healthy eating program with the same after school kids. And they started using the garden. They started planting in the places that weren't planted, some flowers, for example, and some herbs. And they asked if they could use the garden for teaching techniques. So they started using it on a regular basis, you know, when we weren't there. Champaign Park District has their day camps through there, their after school programs, and they've had special events in the garden. The Time Center is a men's homeless shelter that's receiving some of the produce. The Farm Bureau is using our farm in this project as an example of how to get kids engaged in growing food. Prosperity Gardens, they would come over. They have a mobile food market which takes produce that they grow, and some from us, to neighborhoods where people, you know, low income, it's a pay-as-you-can market, but they're taking it to the neighborhood itself, so you're not asking people to, you know, come to the market and we'll help you with some lower price food. They're taking it to the people, and we offered that they could come and harvest out of the Douglas Park Community Garden whenever they wanted on Wednesdays to help, you know, when they were short on produce, to then put it in the mobile market. So they ended up having their own kids and then the Boys and Girls Club youth that they were working with come and work in the garden, and same thing. you know, reap the benefits of the garden and share it with the community in need. So that's what I want to do more of. If we can keep, either maintain or even expand the garden and use it in the way that I have with the after-school program, I'd love to keep that up. But more than that, for all the investments that have been made, I'd love to see more, for it to be seen as a community resource and for more groups to use it, because really, that garden's there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's an opportunity for wonder and food source and trying something new. Do you have a question?
Yeah.
So I'm looking in this next year to see how other, what other ways that this garden can be used, because it's in a very prominent spot. We'd love to see the neighbors take some ownership and get involved if they're interested. And I had one thing that I wanted to share, which is really why I do this. So we came out on April 1st this last year, and we left some, you know, we left some things in the ground, like everybody does. Like, you miss some potatoes, you miss some carrots. So we were kind of making the map of where we were going to plant things, and we were starting to scratch the surface and you know, get some soil ready for direct seeding. And the kids found this little bit of green, which is so hopeful in the springtime. And they then all of a sudden, you know, all went and got their little trowels and huddled around here and unearthed a carrot and, you know, kind of wouldn't let go of the carrot. And Marlo, ran inside and washed the carrot. I mean, this is all just like boom, boom, boom. It's like so much excitement for the kids because they'd found something there from the previous year. And really, like, they were so proud. They were so excited to see that. This is, we all go by vegetable names, so my name's Tracy, and I'm Turnip Tracy. This is melon, Marlo melon. This is hot pepper Hazel, and this is jalapeno John. And they, you know, really, you see some of these kids tussle and argue over different things, but really, when they find something like that, they're thrilled, and you see these partnerships come together and them helping each other and in ways that, you know, when they first come fresh from school and they have all this energy, like, you're not really seeing that cooperation. But in the garden, the kind of the wonder and the excitement pulls them together in an awesome way. You also see faces like this, like Caleb Carrot, who we kept telling him, you know, look for the carrot that's like this big on top. And he, I don't know if you can see it, the carrot is like that one. But because he chose Caleb Carrot, he kind of felt like it was his duty to pull every carrot out of the ground. This is one of the water fights that was started. This is Brooklyn Beets, who, you know, loves her carrots. So anyway, it's been a pleasure to work with these kids. It's been a pleasure to see, you know, what their ideas are, what they're willing to do. And we have lots of fresh ideas for this next coming growing season. Thank you to Sarah for your support and believing in this project and helping us reach more people in the community with good food. Thank you.
I'm just curious who manages the scheduling that then, if there's multiple programs that aren't really related using the same garden, who is ultimately in charge of making sure, you know, there's something there for kids multiple days a week?
So the Douglas Park Community Center staff they are connected with us, and we are there on Fridays unless something special is needed. They're in touch with Prosperity Gardens. They're in touch with Common Ground Food Co-op. So if somebody wants to schedule a program in the garden, they're calling the people on site. And really, I mean, aside from my work with the after-school program, the Park District, because it's their site, they always have, you know, kind of first choice. If they're going to have a day camp in there, that would, you know, that's a taken spot. But largely, and it's just a courtesy also, so you don't have people just wandering in and taking food, which I know has happened, which I don't actually, no one's really concerned about, because I think for the most part, if someone comes in and takes food, they need it, and that's part of a community garden also.
I'm curious about the garden club or even the after school program. Did you have those kids 5 days a week all the time, and for how many hours a day did you meet with them?
So the after school program does run every single day of the week, 5 days a week throughout the academic school year. I am there once every 2 weeks. So I'm director of the Sola Gratia Farm. Most of my work is on the farm. This is a special project aside. I wish I had more time because it goes so fast. I have about 2 hours each time I'm with them. And really, I was mentioning to someone earlier that, you know, when we started, I had these big plans and multiple activities, and really what it comes down to is having, you know, a few ideas and some flexibility and following their lead. I'm much more kind of shooting from the hip and being flexible with them, because it didn't work for me to come, you know, with my structure plans of here's what we're going to do. Generally, we'd have an idea as if this is going to be a harvest day, this is going to be a planting day. We talked about blocking and root shoots and fruits, and, you know, they have their own ideas and they have their own, you know, excitement and curiosities and things that they want to try out. So in the second year, it's been a little more loosey-goosey and kind of working with their leads.